Burnout is the feeling of doing too much yet not enough. It's like swimming for the shore against heavy currents that pull you back. It's the never-ending pile of work. It's thinking that you're about to catch up with your goalpost, but it keeps getting further and further and further away. It's physical, it's mental, it's emotional, and I've had enough. Burnout is defined as a syndrome conceptualized as resulting from chronic workplace stress that has not been successfully managed. In 2021, a survey with over 2,000 Australian and New Zealand workers found that 4 out of 5 people were suffering from burnout. People having to go to the office will feel overwhelmed with the open plan spaces, having to be around people and be in a society, and having to face the pressure of being on all the time. People working from home have a different set of problems with having that lack of separation from work and home, the social isolation, the late and sometimes even longer working hours, and the never decreasing workload as well. No matter what you do, you never feel like you have enough time, and you never feel like what you're doing is enough. Burnout can show up in a few different ways. You can experience feelings of energy depletion or exhaustion, resulting in a constant state of tiredness and low energy. You may face increased mental distance from your job and feeling out of touch. You may experience reduced professional efficacy, where you don't feel like you're able to work as efficiently and as effectively as you could. You may experience difficulties in being able to concentrate and be creative. It can even be physical, with stomach pains and headaches. And you may face a constant state of negativity about work and your colleagues that starts seeping into your fabric of life and your everyday thinking. It's messy, it's exhausting, and it can be horribly demotivating. So I don't know about you guys, but I've been feeling like I've been running on low fuel for months. So I decided to do some research and do a bit of digging to try and find some strategies and tips on how you can cope with burnout, and I wanted to share it with you today. So tip number one is to identify one small change that you can make at work. So if you're working in a team at an organization and you're putting in your best efforts to do your work, just remind yourself that your high workload may not necessarily be your fault. Have a chat to your team members to see if there is a better way that you can distribute your workload. Try and see if there's a way that you can improve your communication in order to better streamline your processes. If you happen to work individually and autonomously most of the time, I would recommend speaking to your manager to try and reduce your workload or prioritize your work tasks so that you are focusing your efforts and your energy into the tasks that are most important and most urgent for you to complete at this time. This step does require you to be more reflective so that you can better assess your work. By making these small changes, you are taking back some of the autonomy and control into your work life, and it'll hopefully encourage you to reassess your work to try and see if there are any other small changes that you can make to better improve your productivity, your efficiency, but also your well-being as well. So tip number two is to set up your work boundaries. Now, in this day and age of social media and technology, I feel like people have constant access to us. When you're working in an office, people can just come up to you and speak to you anytime. When you're working from home, you're accessible through Teams and Zoom calls and meetings. And speaking from the perspective of an introvert who gets nervous around having to speak to people all the time or having to constantly message people, sometimes for me, it can be a bit too much. So what I've started to do nowadays is I actually have it set up on my work email that I don't receive any work emails past the point of 6 p.m. So when I leave work, I really, truly leave work. So depending on your job and role, set some boundaries in a way that best suits you so that you can better care for yourself and really invest your energy into the work activities that matter. A really good quote that I love and came across years ago is actually a quote that I have on my mirror today. And the quote is, "If you really put a small value upon yourself, rest assured that the world will not raise your price." And it always reminds me to put myself first and always prioritize myself, because nobody else is going to do that for me. Tip number three is to balance time spent with loved ones with some alone time. While I'm all for staying socially connected, I think it's important to make those interactions meaningful, but still give yourself enough time to socially recover and rest. Something I started doing recently is I actually schedule pockets of my day that is dedicated to responding to messages from my friends and family. And in that sense, I get to pace myself and actually allow myself to give them the proper response without feeling pressured. Tip number four is to take small breaks throughout the day. Now, I just want to remind you that we're not expected to be performing at 100% every single minute of every single day. So what I would recommend between work tasks or between Zoom calls and meetings, I would recommend that you take micro brain breaks of 10 to 15 minutes where you just get up and you can either stretch or do some exercise. If you're able to, maybe go outside and do a walk around the block for 10 to 15 minutes where you're able to take in some sunshine and just breathe in some fresh air. Or if you're like me, what I usually do for that 10 to 15 minutes, I usually walk around the office or just walk around my house and make myself a cup of tea because you can never have enough tea. Tip number five is to be mindful of what you put into your body. Now, I'm very, very guilty of doing this, but when I'm feeling stressed or overworked, I tend to snack and eat lots of junk food and get takeout for dinner as opposed to eating proper, good, healthy meals. I've had friends who drink lots of coffee and energy drinks to try and compensate for how tired they are and get a little bit of energy into them. So what I would recommend instead is you try to be more mindful with buying fruits and oats to kind of keep at home instead of always buying chips and chocolate. And what I've started to do is to buy pre-prepared meals to actually prevent myself from being able to get takeout for dinner. So tip number six, and this is such an important one for me, is to stop sabotaging your sleep. Now, this may not apply to everyone, but if you didn't know this about me, I am a night owl, so getting to bed by or before 1 a.m. is considered early for me. And I also suffer from this condition known as revenge bedtime procrastination, where I stay up past beyond the point of being tired to try and reclaim some of that personal and me time that I didn't feel like I got throughout the day. And when this happens, I sometimes go to bed as late as 3, 4, or even 5 a.m. And bearing in mind that I usually get up at 8 a.m. to go to work the next day, it's just not great. Nowadays, I'm trying to be a bit more mindful about putting away my technology and dimming my lights beforehand to get myself into the space of being able to go to sleep. Sleep is self-care, and preventing yourself from sleeping just perpetuates this vicious cycle of you wanting to get more sleep but denying yourself from it. And this is probably the most important tip that I need to follow. Tip number seven is to do one small thing a day that makes you happy. When you're overworking yourself or you're emotionally exhausted, it can be so easy to just get on TikTok or on Netflix and just lose yourself in it for the next 2 to 3 hours. But what I would recommend is that you spend 20 to 30 minutes of your day doing something that makes you really happy. And this can look different for everybody. For some people, it may be reading or exercising or knitting, but reclaiming the time that is yours and choosing to spend at least some of it mindfully and willingly will help you be more proactive towards your own well-being. The last and final tip is to practice self-compassion. Reaching the point of burnout can bring up feelings of failure and a loss of purpose or sense of direction in your life. If you've reached the point of burnout, chances are you've probably already gone beyond the point of what a person should realistically be capable of doing for that period of time. So what I would recommend is that you practice some self-compassion and you offer yourself up the same kind of empathy and kindness that you would to a good friend. Remind yourself that you shouldn't have to feel like you need to perform at 100% every single minute of every single day. It's okay to take a break, and it's okay to not always feel positive, productive, and energetic throughout your whole day. So those are my 8 tips for you. I know that none of them were necessarily groundbreaking. I'm super guilty for doing some of the bad habits that I mentioned today, so I'm hoping that this video serves as a reminder to myself, but also yourself as well, to take care of your emotions, your body, and your mind during these difficult times. If you haven't already done so, be sure to subscribe to my channel for more content on sustainability and self-development. Be sure to give this video a thumbs up if you liked it and found it useful, and comment down below what sort of tips and tricks that you use during these times to cope with burnout, and share this video with your friends and family if you think that it'll help them as well. Thank you so much for watching my video, and I'll see you in my next one. Bye!